Aloha and welcome to our regular weekly show, Condo Insider. About 30 to 40% of our population live in an association in Hawaii, and we try to educate both board members and homeowners on what it's like to live in a condo, what the issues are, and what their responsibilities may be. We've decided to do something a little bit different for the next 4 weeks. Last year, the Real Estate Commission, we have continuing education for realtors. And the course B for last year's mandatory education for realtors was Condominium Law 514B. It's a 3-hour course. So I've decided to bring in a real expert on this, and I'm going to ask him in a minute why he's an expert, but Scott Shirley, who's been with us before, and talk about over the next 4 weeks, we're going to divide this real estate mandatory class into four parts and deal very specifically with what the law is for 514B and what your requirements are. So Scott, again, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you for having me again. Obviously, I've done a good job. You had me back.
I couldn't find anybody else.
I figured as much.
Not true. But you just don't get to go teach this course on continuing education. Tell us about the course itself in general terms and why you're qualified to talk about it.
Well, every 2 years, a real estate licensee has to take 20 hours of continuing education in order to renew their license. And part of that 20 hours is two mandatory core courses, as they call them. And the last licensing period of 15-16, the Real Estate Commission decided that what they refer to as the hot topic for those two classes was going to be on condominiums. So in 2015, the topic was how condos are created. And then more exciting to me was Core B, which was last year, which was the governance, how condo associations are governed. And of course, in order to teach this course, you have to attend a session. You and I both attended a training session on this. And I've actually been doing real estate continuing education for over 20 years, including writing my own courses. And you and I have actually team taught this particular course a couple of times last year. And I think it was an excellent course to have realtors understand what goes on in a condominium.
Yeah, actually, I was impressed with it. And meanwhile, we've lobbied the Real Estate Commission, and this course is actually about to be online for anybody to take it online. You don't have to be a realtor. Anybody can go and kind of get the very specific, because my experience is 514B is often misunderstood and it gets confused with the old 514A, which we'll come back to, but not to give you a surprise question, but so when is a condominium created? How is it created? Does it come from the heavens in a lightning bolt, or how is a condominium created?
Well, it's not a quick and easy process. And under 514B, it has the whole section on how to create a condominium. And of course, it also goes through a review by the condominium consultant, which is hired by the state to review all the documents that are going to create the condominium on paper. And that includes the bylaws, declarations, and things like that. And the Real Estate Commission in itself doesn't approve the project to be built. It approves the documents that create the condominium, but it's still up to the individual counties to approve whether or not that condo is going to be built in the way that it's been created.
And all that's very true, but on a very technical basis, a condominium is created, number one, when they submit the fee interest or the lease interest into the condominium property regime.
Yes.
And number two, they file their declaration.
Yep.
They can't sell it. They may not have any rights, but it's really born and becomes a legal entity the moment the fee or the leasehold interest is submitted to the condominium property regime and when the declaration is recorded with the Bureau of Conveyances, and that's where it suddenly becomes born and an entity.
And you and I have been around long enough, maybe too long, where we remember it wasn't called a condominium property regime back under 514A. It was called a horizontal property regime, but horizontal condos can be more than horizontal. So when they recodified the law into 514B, they changed it to condominium property regime.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. I was talking to an architect the other day, and he was giving a class, and he says, tell me what a horizontal property regime is. I said, it's an distinct entity.
I like that.
He looked at me and said, what do you mean? I said, well, they changed it to mean condominium property regime. So even though you'll find HPR, horizontal property regime, all over the place, it's the identical thing as a condominium property regime, CPR, but the current language everywhere is a CPR, not an HPR, and a lot of people don't understand that.
Well, there was also one other tiny little change when they recodified the law, and that was we still commonly refer to it as an AOAO, Association of Apartment Owners, but 514B changed it to Association of Unit Owners, AOUO, because a condominium can be more than a apartment. It could be air. You have what they call airspace condominiums. It could be a storage facility. It could be commercial. And I actually heard one of my students telling me they almost, but didn't quite finish it, almost condominiumized boat slips.
And well, I can believe that.
I thought to myself, why the hell didn't I think of that?
Yeah. Well, one of the interesting things about that, I just want to briefly mention before we go into part one of the 514B, is that we all know there's 514A, the original act, mm-hmm. followed by 514B. Then Section 5, governance in 514B, automatically applies to 514A, whether you opted into 514B or not. What a lot of people don't know is it creates confusion in the marketplace. I'm confused enough already. But that being said, there are two bills before the legislature today to sunset or retire 514A, that it will become repealed and no longer in existence. Mm-hmm. And so the goal is to have 514B repealed effective January 1, 2019. And people say, why January 2019? Because believe it or not, there's some very old public reports out there where the developer hasn't quite finished his condominium. They used all the 514A language, even though it's been overridden by 514B in certain areas. And so they're giving them a chance at a low cost to get off the pot and get the condominium developed or not. But at the end of the day, there still be no 514A.
And part of the reason behind that as well is, too, is it's usually small developments or mom-and-pop developments, as they call it. So they're giving them an opportunity to get that all cleaned up before 514A fades away. And personally, I think it's been a long time coming.
Oh, I think so, and there's a lot of reasons why it didn't go that way. But going back to the purpose of this next 4 weeks, to educate so all of our board members and homeowners truly understand every comma, semicolon in 514B, let me just summarize the course and what we're going to do for the next 4 weeks. When you look at the objective of the course for the realtors, it was to accomplish four things. Number one, governance structure. Number two, governance process. Number three, fiscal matters, financial matters. And four, review certain issues that are commonly misunderstood.
Yeah.
So today's show, part one, we're going to talk about government structure. And then in future shows, we'll, the next two, three, and four, we'll discuss the other issues that are in this course that realtors took. So anyway, governance structure. What is the basic concept or structure for governance of condominiums?
Well, it's called self-governance in that I liken it to your typical county. In your county or even the state, even at the state level, you elect a governor, you elect a legislature, and their job is to maintain the state, fix the roads, fill the potholes, whatever the case may be. And that's the idea under self-governance, is that the owners of the association elect a board, and their job is to maintain the property, fix the parking lot, maintain the exterior of the building, and things like that. So the idea of self-governance is not any different than how the county runs its job or how the state runs its job. It's the owners through the board of directors who maintain and run their property.
Well, I guess the best way to describe it was, it's not practical to think that all the decisions at the association will be made by a majority vote of the owners. It's not practical. Because we have owners who live here, owners who live in the mainland, people who are on vacation, on and on and on. So it's just not practical. So like you used as an example, associations are governed by elected board who's elected by the homeowners under mm-hmm. certain rules and conditions, which we'll get to in part two of the 514B next week. But the concept behind it is they had the greatest stake in this. We're electing people who have the greatest stake. The owners are electing them. And as in a republic, you know, they're going to set the rules. It's not, quote, democratic, because that would mean everybody voted on everything.
Yeah.
And so the basic principle is self-governance. And what are, when you form this condominium, you have this self-governance, briefly name the three typical documents that exist in a condominium. I know there's exceptions, incorporated, all these different yep. things, but let's keep this simple and deal with the basic three documents that are the cornerstone of condominium governance.
They're the cornerstone, and it's a document documents that every owner should be familiar with, especially at the time that they were purchasing it, and that would be your bylaws, your declarations, and your house rules. And of course, on top of that, you have 514B state law that applies in certain areas. But your bylaws are your true governing document. Your declaration tells you what you own, basically. And the house rules are telling you basically what you can and cannot do in your unit or with your unit and things like that. Important things to know when you're buying into a condominium.
Yes, and I think we have to admit, people should understand coming in the door, when they buy into a condominium, they're giving up certain rights you may feel that you're entitled to by being an American or a Hawaiian citizen or whatever it may be. But when you move into a condominium, you're basically agreeing to these governing documents. And we'll come back to those in a second. And you're going to abide by them, and you're going to accept yep. the governance of your board, and which may mean you have to give up certain rights. For example, you might like to swim in the pool at 11 p.m. at night, but there are pool rules. The pool closes at 10 p.m. at night. So you are going to be forced to give up certain things
yeah.
or change your lifestyle that you might not be what you originally were used to in a house.
Comments have been made that you give up rights in a condominium that you normally would not give up if you were living, say, in a typical subdivision in Hawaii Kai or Mililani. But that's not necessarily true either, because when you buy into one of those subdivisions, they have restrictive codes and covenants that say you can't paint your house purple and green and things like that. So even if you're not in a condo and you're in a typical subdivision, there are rules there too that you have to abide by when you live there.
But briefly, we talked about the three basic documents. I'm going to summarize them. Mm-hmm. Correct me if I'm wrong, although the last time I was wrong was 1971. But we'll forget that. A little bit of history for you. But the reality of it is, there's the Declaration. That's the highest document. It's mm-hmm. like the Constitution. It defines what your obligations are to the project. What you pay for, what you pay maintenance fees for, which is a common expense of the association, what you own and have to fix, what the association
yes.
owns has to fix. It may define what we call limited common elements, where you get to use something. Personally, it's assigned to your apartment, but it's still owned as a common element by the association. That declaration defines governance by saying we will have bylaws.
Mm-hmm.
And the governance sets the size of the board, when they're elected, all sorts of rules of governance and about voting and proxies, a whole bunch of other things. And then finally, because you live in a condominium, they will set up house rules with regard to parking, pool hours, quiet time, to make the place safe and comfortable, quiet enjoyment for the people who live there.
Yeah.
Is that a fair way to the?
That's an absolute fair way. And I also liken the house rules to, I call them common sense rules, because of things like quiet times and stuff like that. Although I'm beginning to think common sense has become a superpower now in these days, but they're yeah. common sense rules. You don't have parties or loud music yeah. after 10 o'clock. You're no nude swimming after 11. You know.
And we're going to take a quick break, but I just want to again say that the declaration is the highest.
Mm-hmm.
So if the bylaws is different than the declaration will take precedent.
Yes.
And the bylaws will take precedent over the house rules.
Exactly.
So that's the order of priority, mm-hmm. kind of like federal law, state law, that kind of
yep.
a thing. But we're going to take a short break on Condo Insider. We'll be back in 1 minute with more on part one of 514B.
You're watching ThinkTech Hawaii, citizen journalism from Hawaii. Finding the intersection of our sense of place and our place in the world, right here at home. Great content for Hawaii from ThinkTech.
Hello, this is Martin Despang. I want to get you excited about my new show, which is called Humane Architecture for Hawaii and Beyond, and it's going to be on ThinkTech Hawaii from downtown Honolulu on Tuesday afternoons, 5 p.m. And we're going to talk about to make architecture more inclusive on the islands, which is one of the definitions of humane, which is being tolerant of many people, of nature, of many other influences. So we're going to have some great guests, like today's guest, for example, my collaborator David Rockwood, who is the author of the awesome manifestation of humane architecture in the background. So see you on Tuesdays, 5 p.m. I look forward to.
Welcome back to Condo Insider. We're on the very early discussions of Hawaii Condominium Law 514B. And we've invited Scott Shirley, who's my resident expert on this matter, since he has been qualified to teach this by the Real Estate Commission. And again, our goal is to go through 514B over the next 4 weeks in sufficient detail that hopefully all of you will understand it better. So we talked about the declaration, the bylaws, and the house rules, and self-governance, and the board makes these decisions and sets the rules, et cetera. Are these enforceable? I mean, can courts enforce? I mean, how much power is there in these rules? Or are they going to snub your nose at you and say we don't have to follow it?
These rules are very important, and they're all binding upon the homeowner. As soon as you close escrow and own that unit, you have now become a member of that association. And as a member of that association, you are bound to all the documents, like the declarations, bylaws, and house rules that govern the use and control of the property itself.
So are these fines enforceable, or can you get injunctive relief from a court if someone says I'm not going to do it, which I've seen many times, by the way?
It depends on the rule. You know, some boards can get a little heavy-handed or carried away in some of their house rules, where it might be determined, no, that was just too much. But generally speaking, the bylaws and the declarations, that's the written in stone rules for the association, and very rarely do they change, although they can be amended, but that takes a vote of the association.
Owners and board members ought to be aware that that these are supported by the courts. The courts will enforce the fines and enforce injunctive release to prevent you from doing something, of which under the statute those costs can be charged back if it's the owner refusing to do it, back to the owner. All those legal fees can be charged back to them. And the courts are actually enforcing those. So it's not something you should just snub your nose at and ignore and figure you're just an owner or two on the board, I'm not going to do it. That could create problems for you.
Yeah. You would want, as living in a condominium, and it's been my joke for many years, everyone's entitled to buy a condominium. But not everybody was meant to live that close to other people. So sometimes that fit of living in a condominium sometimes doesn't always work. But that doesn't mean you're not bound by these, because you are a member of that association.
And we also talked that the declaration defines like the common elements and the limited common elements, which the association is responsible for, which you pay for indirectly through maintenance fees. Mm-hmm. And then you have your apartment that you're responsible for. So what happens, because I own my apartment, it's 3 o'clock in the morning, and the pipe breaks in my apartment, and I'm saying, I'm not going to let you in. It's the middle of the night. I don't want you coming in my apartment.
Can they force themselves in, the resident manager or the resident manager with the plumber, to stop it? And the answer is yes. The board has a duty to protect not only the limited common elements, or the common elements, but also protect other units that might get damaged from what's happening in your unit. And you and I both know, after all these years, usually when you're asleep is not when the pipe breaks. It's usually when you leave for vacation or you left for work. And it's back in the days when waterbeds were still popular. They never sprung a leak while you were sleeping in them. They only sprung a leak when you left for work that day.
Well, just to give you a quick example, because we have a really heavy schedule today, but I had a property manager who there was a water leak in an apartment on the second floor, causing water to go into the first floor, called gravity. And it was a grave situation, and it was gravity was causing the problem. And what happened was the property manager, our property manager, went to the door, and the front door was unlocked and open, but the screen door was closed. knocked on a door, yelled a few times, can I get your attention? We need some help because this unit was leaking. Yeah. And so she stepped inside the front door by about 4 feet, and the owner came out screaming at her, you're trespassing, and actually filed a lawsuit against her saying she was trespassing. And the court not only threw out the lawsuit, but made him pay thousands of dollars in legal fees because the board had the right to go in and stop this problem. And this person lacked what I call common sense. But there are just some people who, like you said, like to twist people's tails. So owners need to understand, yeah, and board needs to understand that they have an obligation to protect the property and the safety of everybody, and they have a right to enter private property, the apartment, in emergency situations.
I think that's another good point that you made, is not only to protect the property, the safety of the other owners there. You don't know what that water leak's going to cause. It could short out things. I was just reading an article the other day where the power went out in a particular town in the middle of the night, and somebody was on an automatic oxygen machine. Fortunately, they had a backup. But can you see if something like that happened in a condominium and you couldn't get in there to stop the leak and it shorted out a system where somebody is on oxygen,
sure,
or something
that's important. The other thing the law does in the before we get into the actual governance process, it imposes a fiduciary duty obligation on the board. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it doesn't define fiduciary duty. So tell me in simple words, what is the fiduciary duty of a board?
Well, the fiduciary duty of a board, and it falls also in line with the National Association of Realtors, with realtors and their obligation to their clients and customers, is you owe a duty of obedience, diligence, ordinary care, loyalty, good faith, and what they call the business judgment rule. I've always pointed out, like on the business judgment rule, the board can make a decision today that seems like the right thing to do, and then maybe 2 years later it turns out that wasn't the right decision. But the board's not going to be held liable because they made a business decision based on the information they had at that time.
Well, and so the real issue is, when you look at a board, their fiduciary responsibility is to the association,
yes,
the entity, which makes it indirectly to members, but not to the members directly.
Yeah.
So it's really an obligation to make sure that it's the highest standard of care in the law today, is, mm-hmm, the fiduciary duty. It is the highest standard of care. So they have an obligation to, first of all, like a managing agent, we're an agent for the board, so we owe them obedience. If they're not breaking the law and they say, yeah, even though we think that's not the best business judgment decision, but it's not illegal, we can guide them, but they still have the right. And once they make a legal decision, managing agents have that responsibility, obedience, to support them,
yes,
what they're doing.
Exactly.
And then diligence or ordinary care means that when you have an issue before you, you're supposed to go carefully study it and look at it. And because you're not an expert in plumbing or architecture or law, rely on professionals. That's the business judgment rule.
Yeah.
That you can protect yourself from personal liability if, in fact, you have relied on experts or people who are licensed to, and you're following the decisions they recommend, you know, or the answers they recommend. So, and then, like you said, you owe them loyalty and you owe them good faith dealings. And that's what a fiduciary duty is. And in our next show, we're going to talk about conflicts of interest a little bit, but not today, because we have a tight schedule on this. To do this whole 514B, and I said 4 weeks, it might take us 4 years to do this. It's a complex thing. So anyway, you know, so a fiduciary owes them obedience, loyalty, diligence, and good faith in their, yeah, decision-making. And so who can serve on the board?
Well, the real question to that is, why would you serve on the board? No, yeah, not really. But the person who can serve on the board is an owner of record. That could even be somebody who owns under an agreement of sale, a trustee for a trust, or a corporation. Those are good examples of an owner. Typically, it's usually, you know, husband and wife are the owner, and then you have occasionally where both the husband and the wife want to run for the board. Can they?
Well, they can if they own more than one unit.
Well, they can, but only one can be elected if they only own one unit.
Yeah.
You can't have more than one representative of that unit.
That's right. You're only going to have one representative for one unit, but if you had someone who owned two apartments, then the husband and wife could serve,
yep,
one under apartment one and one under apartment two.
Exactly.
With respect to it. But how about corporations? Sometimes this unit's owned by a corporation. Mm-hmm. Who can serve from the corporation?
Whoever the corporation has designated as their representative on for that particular unit.
Yeah. Two quick stories on that. Number one, before the legislature today is a proposed law, because we have sometimes a unit owned by a church and or a corporation, and it has that vague language, or their designated representative. It doesn't say an officer of the corporation. It could be whoever they want to designate. So sometimes what happens is that entity appoints a tenant, and that upsets the board because they really don't have anything at stake there with respect to the common elements. They just want to keep it cheap and their rent low. And so the current bill prohibits tenants, if it gets adopted, from serving on the board, which will prevent corporations and or churches or other entities from appointing someone that doesn't have some direct relationship to the entity that owns it, either by an officer or somewhere along that line. But I was at an annual meeting on Monday last week, and what we had was a trustee of a trust. We had it in writing they were a trustee of a trust. And then during the year, they were not reappointed to the trust. And so the attorney for the association said, that creates a vacancy now. He's not on the trust. He can't serve, which is the correct ruling.
Yeah.
And so what happened was an owner suggested that the board pass a resolution to opt out of the state law. I know. And I suggested she opt out of the state altogether and not pay taxes. But the reality of it is that you can't do things like that.
Well, that would be sort of like you and I waiving the speed limit.
That's right.
You and I have agreed that we don't have to drive 55, but that's not going to hold up with the police officer that pulls us over.
Well, anyway, we've actually run out of time. I can't believe it. And we're almost done part one, so we'll have one little question beginning next week. But again, this is part of a four-part series to go through 514B in detail. You can always call in on our hotline. We'll give you the number next time. But thank you for listening to Condo Insider, and hope to see you next week.
Hi, this is Jane Sugimura. I'm the co-host for Condo Insider, and we're on ThinkTech Hawaii every Thursday at 3 o'clock, and we're here to talk about condominium living and issues that affect condominium residents and owners, and I hope you'll join us every week on Thursday. Aloha.